I have the honor to be the president of the defense committee, and I thank my colleagues. So we are here to for your the presentation of your work. The title of your thesis is Controlling Earthquakes in the Laboratory Using Thermal Force Stimulating Techniques. You have prepared your PhD thesis under the supervision of Professor Yoannis Stefanou. And I'm just going very quickly present to the members of the committee. So first of all, the two reviewers, André Muschneider, who is an associate professor at Utrecht University in the Netherlands. The second one is Gino Giadi, who is a professor in University Grenoble in France. And the other members, Jean-Philippe Avouac, who is professor in Caltech in USA, Rachel Jollet, maître de conférence, University of Nantes in France, Ares Rosakis, professor in Caltech in USA, and Jean-François Sandla, professor at NSTAR Paris. And I am Franck Lestan, professor here in the central. So you have now 45 minutes to make your presentation.
Thank you very much. Can we first remove this?
Yes, in principle, it's possible. High floating mini controls. Control Alt Shift H.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you see my pointer?
Yes.
Good. Okay. So, dear members of the committee, dear all, it's a great honor for me today to present you the work I've been doing the last 3 years under the supervision of Professor Yoannis Stefanou in ZEM laboratory of the Ecole Centrale de Nantes. The title of my PhD thesis is Controlling Earthquakes in the Laboratory Using Pertinent Fault Simulating Techniques, and is part of an ERC project called Cockwake. Before going into the details, I have a surprise for you. An earthquake control experiment is running now in our laboratory. Yes, here you can see it's live now on YouTube, but I won't share the link with you. But wait until the end in order to show you in details how it's going experiment. So let's advance. So why researchers care about controlling earthquakes? Earthquakes are one of the most destructive phenomena of the whole spectrum of natural disasters. Their consequences are irreversible and financially devastating. Natural earthquakes occur all around the globe, as you can see in this animation on the right, in the boundary layers between tectonic plates. An example of such an earthquake is the deadliest natural disaster for 2021 in Haiti this summer of magnitude 7.2. And as you can see from the pictures and from the data, this earthquake was indeed destructive. Apart from natural earthquakes, there are also anthropogenic ones. The number of these earthquakes is increasing nowadays due to the intense human activity for energy production. These earthquakes occur all around the world, but they might occur also next to us. Take as an example the induced earthquake of magnitude 3.9 in Strasbourg due to a geothermal project working close to the city. There are numerous techniques in the literature where they try to mitigate seismicity. And the first attempt was the field control experiment in Radley, Colorado, published by Riley et al. 1976. Another techniques, more recent ones that they used from the industry are the traffic light system and the fracture cage. All these techniques share a common characteristic. All these, they are not based on mathematics. And of course, the most important one, they cannot answer the following question. Can earthquakes be controlled? So in my thesis today, I'm gonna show you three main objectives. First of all, I explore mathematically if the earthquake instability can be prevented and propose a new theory for earthquake control. I apply this theory to various numerical examples. And finally, I test this theory by performing laboratory experiments. But what is an earthquake? Due to the far field movement of the tectonic plates, elastic energy is stored in the crust. And after a certain point, when an instability condition is met, this elastic energy is abruptly released, resulting to a dynamic instability where we call earthquake. Then seismic waves travels to the surface and destroy our infrastructure. An idealized model of earthquakes is the single degree of freedom fringe slider model, where it consists of a mobilized mass which slides on top of a frictional surface by applying a constant velocity at an extremity of an elastic spring. The motion of this spring slider is governed mainly by the elastic force that you can see here in the figure with the red dashed line, and the friction force, which is the black solid line. The green dot corresponds to the intersection of these two lines, and it's the equilibrium point. As time advances, elastic energy is stored to the system, but this force is really, really slow. It's of the order of years. When this dot reaches the peak, and if there is sufficient weakening, so an instability condition holds, then any tiny perturbation will destabilize this equilibrium point, and there will be no more equilibrium point, and we'll jump the system directly to the green dot that you see down there. And this process is really, really fast. This is what we call an earthquake, and it takes around some, it's on the order of some seconds. The blue shaded area corresponds to the radiated energy to the environment. Friction is one of the governing forces in this problem, and it's one of the biggest unknowns. Many researchers have been trying in the last years to find a suitable constitutive law which best represents reality. To this direction was also the PhD thesis of director, Alexander Stathas, who defended his thesis some days ago. So the most common friction loss in fault mechanics are the slip weakening and the random state friction loss. And also I adapt for my thesis these two friction to these two frictions. And one condition, one property that we want these frictions to have is to be life's continuous function. And we want this property because when we will apply our control approach later on, we want our friction to be bounded with respect to the states. And we are, and hopefully both frictions are life's as we can see in this block. And remember, keep in mind this property because we're gonna use it later on. Qualitatively speaking, an isolated earthquake event, the response of an isolated earthquake event is as shown in this figure. So when an earthquake occurs, the slip in terms of time is a step-like response, and the slip rate is a pulse-like response. In a fault of 5 kilometers, this corresponds to a maximum slip of 0.6 meters for both slip weakening and rate of state friction, and a maximum Vmax of 0.10 meters per second, again for both of them. The friction in terms of slip is identical, as we can see, resulting in an earthquake of 5.7 for both of them. So we can conclude that there is a similar dynamic response for isolated earthquake events. But what happens when fluid is injected into the earth's crust? According to Coulomb's friction and trajectory principle, when fluid is injected, you can see here, influences friction. And if we perform a linear stability analysis and derive the instability conditions for an earthquake to occur, we find the relation that the elasticity of the surrounding rocks should be smaller than the characteristic stiffness that's a function of the frictional parameters and the effective stress. So the question is now, what if we add that much fluid, we inject that much fluid in order to make this system stable? So by increasing the pressure, we favor stability. But wait, this doesn't contradict the induced seismicity that I told you before? Well, something else happens practically. When we are close to a critically stressed fault, we expect the natural earthquake to occur if no injection of fluid takes place. However, when fluid is injected, we see that the system cannot reach the equilibrium point, the previous one, and it jumps down, really down to the reduced friction, the residual one, which is the new equilibrium point, resulting in a larger induced earthquake. So practically, we can see here that P gives an input to the system. We can alter the dynamics of the fault system. However, what if we don't try to do it with brute force? What if we try by progressively releasing the energy by small injections and nucleating small earthquakes? And we try this by mimicking induced seismicity performing surrogate experiments using paper towel. Paper towel is a low cost commercial material. And we just cut some stripes of it and we put it under induction. But how on earth a paper stripe could mimic a fault system and its friction? So we can see the characteristic response here on the right on the figure that during traction, there's an elastic slope initially, it reaches a peak, and then after that peak, it fails abruptly and brittle. In a brittle manner and has a really steep weakening slope. When, on the other hand, this stripe is under wet conditions, then as we expect, we get a lower peak resistance of the material and a more ductile post-peak behavior, like 2 to 3 times smaller. So practically, this behavior resembles with the friction behavior we saw before with the spring slider. So what we want to do now is to somehow mimic this scenario that we have on the left. So we have a fault that we segmentized in 5 pieces, in 5 segments, and at each segment we install an injection well. This injection well can inject water only on the specific segment. And to that extent, by sequentially injecting at each segment, we will try to mitigate the stored energy. And so these two systems are equivalent in terms of energy. And and if we put 5 stripes in parallel, as the single stripe that we characterized before, this corresponds to a fault of 6.5 kilometers. And if we use the swing system above for elastic energy storage, and if we start pushing above the ramp, we simulate the far-field tectonic displacement. The fluid injections are simulated by wetting the paper stripes. So let's see a natural paper wake. You can see on the right the video. It's a video. You see here the abrupt instability. And these are the experimental data that you can see on the left, the force versus displacement. And you can see in the red hat area, the energy that is released to the environment, which corresponds to an earthquake of 5.9. On the right, we have the displacement and velocity in terms of time. And we can see that the displacement has a step-like response and the velocity is a pulse-like response, as we expect. So now we try to mitigate this earthquake by sequentially injecting at this stripe. And every time that we inject, as we have seen already, we provoke an earthquake. And here what we get. The first one we get at 3.9, 3.9, 4.3, 4.4, and lastly a 4.7. And this will continue loading and loading until it fails asymmetrically. Really, really slow. Every time that an earthquake was occurring, we can see a small pulse here in the velocities with the red dust here. However, this experiment started really, really early in terms of the resistance of the material at 20% of the maximum resistance. What if we start our injection policy a bit later at 60%? Then we can see from this experimental data that after the third injection, the paper breaks and an earthquake occurs of magnitude 5.5, equivalent to the natural event. So there is a risk here. Because we don't know this, if we don't know the source level, we risk to provoke a large earthquake event. And apart from the source level, there are also some other uncertainties, like friction, like the elastic properties of rock and others. So what if instead we try to design properly and safely, mostly the pressure, the fluid pressure, as we have seen, in order to produce any seismic slip. And for that, we employ the control theory. Control theory is a discipline of applied mathematics that deals with the control of dynamical systems. And here's an example. You can see of a controlled system. You can see a ball on top of a table, and after applying some perturbations on the ball, the table changes its inclination in order to retrieve the ball back to its center. So this is part of what we want to do in an abstract sense. So our earthquake control strategy looks like this. We have, this is the block diagram. So practically we have the plant. That's the physical process. It's the fault. It's the real fault. It's the diffusion that takes place in the Earth's crust. But ideally, we would like to measure the slip and the slip rate on the fault. But this is impossible. We cannot do that. And we have sufficient measurements. And these measurements could be acquired by GPS, INSAR, or accelerometers, or others. And finally, we end up having measurements just, for instance, the average slip on the fault of the surface. And by using just this measurement, our goal is to design this block here, which consists of a robust controller, observer, and tracking. And this block here will output the control input to the system, which in our problem would be the fluid pressure on the fault interface or at distant wells. So the question is how we design this block here. And practically, we want to design in such a way to assure asymptotic stability of the closed loop system all the time. And we do this by employing the Lyapunov second method for stability. And just for the for background, the observer system is a system that we recreate the states of our plant process, of our physical process, by just having only one measurement, we recreate the states. The tracking means that we wanna reach a specific reference trajectory. For instance, we want to stabilize the seismicity in the region, or we want to induce a slow seismic slip. And robustness. The robustness means that we account for uncertainties in our physical process, which shouldn't be, we couldn't be able to get all the details that we want from our system. We don't know friction, we don't know the stress level, as we said before. So for that, we go to our design of the robust controller, where the mechanics can be illustrated by this equation. Most of the discretization that exists in the literature could result in this equation, where x are the states corresponding to the slip rate and the slip, and p is the fluid pressure on fault interface. The A matrix corresponds to the elasticity and viscosity of the system, the B matrix to friction, and the G nonlinear vector to frictional to the frictional region. If we want to track a specific reference, we will have to augment our system with a number of integrators, where this where R practically is the tracking or reference trajectory. For instance, it could be the slip trajectory we want the fault to follow, and the X dot corresponds to the slip error. And practically, the augmented systems have the forms that is shown in the block here. In the case where we actually take into account diffusion phenomena, we use, in my thesis, I used a 1D diffusion equation, adapting the Seidel and Rice equation, which is, as you can see here, where U corresponds to the fluid pressure at the boreholes, far from the fault. The C sub D coefficient is the diffusivity. And of course, as we can see, all this friction, as I said earlier, friction, diffusivities, elasticity, are uncertain parameters. That's why we decompose them to a known part and an uncertain part. And the equations above take this form that you can see below, where A0 is the nominal elasticity and viscosity of the system, B0 is a nominal friction, C sub D0 is the nominal diffusivity, and the parameters with capital delta corresponds to the uncertain parameters. This H vector that you can see here has to be Leibniz. And as you can see, this G is the friction that I showed you before. And if you remember from the very beginning, friction for our problems is a Leibniz function. And that's why it's a valid assumption to assume that this is a Leibniz function, this H. So we can design a controller using actually inspired by Lyapunov design and by the backstabbing techniques. I developed a new theory of by solving two decoupled continuous algebraic Riccati's equations. And this controller assures that all the closed loop system is exponentially stable of and we prove this using the Lyapunov's second method. What are the ingredients though for a robust control design? What we need to know to do such a design? For that, we need the viscoelastic and diffusion properties below. We want the minimum and maximum length, shear velocity, doubling ratio, and diffusivity of the system. And also in terms of frictional properties, we want the maximum effective normal stress, the minimum and maximum friction coefficient, and the constraint that friction has to be Leibniz. But it's okay, theory is nice, but what if we go and test our model to some numerical applications? For that, we employ an isolated fraction fault, as you can see here, where the fault has a length of 5 kilometers and is discretized with a regular mesh. The effective normal stress varies with depth, as you can see on this plot there. And the mechanic, for the mechanics, we employ a lumped mass matrix, and the stiffness matrix is obtained from the Scenery 1963 and Rice 1993 papers. The friction has to be is heterogeneous in our problem, allowing special log normal distribution. And for the rating state, we assume we consider a regularizer, the regularizer of state friction, and the grid for the rating state case is consists of 400 elements, and for the slip weakening of 900 elements. There's this difference because we want the ratio of the characteristic size of the system over the element over the minimum nucleation size to be at around 0.4 constant for both cases, assuring stable elements as Rice proposed in his paper in 1993. So this is the response of an isolated earthquake event using either slip or random state friction. So the slip takes has also a stepwise response, as we can see here in both cases, and reaches a maximum of 0.6 meters, while the slip rate has a pulse-like response again and reaches a maximum of 0.1 meters per second. This is an instability occurs at a time period of 10 seconds. It's really, really fast. And the frictional profiles, both of them coincide in both cases. And on the far right, we have the control plots of the slip rate distribution along the fault. And we can observe that the maximum slip rate in both cases is the same. So we can conclude that the dynamic response for both friction loss results in similar results. So let's go and apply our control strategy to this example. So we have our fault, and we assume that we have a rating state, a friction with heterogeneous parameters. And what we control in this problem, actually we adjust the fluid pressure at each element, over each element, over the fault. What we could measure the whole state space. We could measure the slip rate at every single element with a magic wave. And what we wanna achieve with this control strategy is we want the fault to follow these trajectories here down below. We want the slip of the fault to follow the black line and the slip rate of the fault to follow the orange line. And for that, we have some parameters, which is the operation time of the control strategy and the maximum design slip, which is the Dmax, which are three parameters. We choose them in order to satisfy some control needs that we might have. So in reality, what we pose here is, instead of having an instability, instead of going from an unstable equilibrium point to a stable one in 10 seconds, what if we do? We apply our control strategy and go from our from the unstable to the stable one in 10 minutes and reach exactly the same point. And this is the target of our control strategy. And if you can see here the response with the dotted line, the dotted line is the response of the system. And you can see that it's that matches exact the, our target, where practically the control did its job. Yes. So practically, as you can see, the maximum velocity that was developed there was around 2 millimeters per second, which is practically three orders of magnitude smaller than the slip rate occurred in the earthquake event. In order to achieve this behavior, though, we had to adjust the pressure on the fault elements. And for that, and here you can see the fluid pressure evolution for the fault. With the solid line, we see the average response, while with the blue shaded line, we see the envelope of the pressures, the minimum and the maximum at each time. Initially, we see that the pressure increases to destabilize the fault, and then pressure decreases because the fault is reactivated and we have to stabilize it until it reaches its new equilibrium point, which is practically the point D that you can see here. And then after that point, energy is stored to the system again, and whenever one would come stop the controller. The second example is a more realistic one. We want to do, we want to approach reality in the sense that we want to account for diffusion phenomena and sparse spatial measurements. And for that, we assume that we inject far from the fault in a distance of LD. For, in this example, we use slip weakening, friction loop, and our control inputs this time is the fluid pressure at each borehole far from the fault. And now what we measure only the average slip at the surface of the fault, only here, nothing else. And what we want to, what the fault has to, what's the response of the fault is this one that you can see on the bottom right, where the slip is the black one, and the slip rate is the orange one. So this is our target for this control approach. For this example, we use the CO2, highly pressurized CO2, where its parameters are these ones. And we have practically two examples. We have the example with four wells and the example with 100 wells. The four wells corresponds to a distance from the hole, from the fault. So the boreholes are placed 2.5 kilometers away from the fault, while in the 100 wells, they are placed 0.5 kilometers from the fault. So in the first example, we see that, again, the controller does the job. We can see that the dotted line follows exactly the dashed one, line behind. And also, the same happens for the slip rate. The maximum slip rate that was produced in this example was 10 minus 8 meters per second. It's 7 orders of magnitude smaller than the dynamic event. And this is the case, of course, because we applied our control strategy for 3 years. So it's too long. To accomplish this behavior, we adjust the fluid pressure far away from the fault in the boreholes level. And this is the green line that you can see here. It's the average fluid pressure at the borehole level, while the blue line corresponds to the respective fluid pressure on the fault level. We can see here on the peak, the inherent time delay that is introduced to the system due to the diffusion equation. And here is a second example with 100 wells, where again we can see that the controller does the job. And now on the fluid pressure profile here, we practically can see that the borehole level and the fault level, they coincide. So there's no time delay. But okay, until now, we are working in a scenario where the fault is more or less known. We know more or less that there exists a fault with some nominal values. But trying to stabilize one fault might destabilize some others nearby. So now we want to use a non-local approach for robust control of seismicity rate, a rate in a more broader region. And for that, we use we assume a reservoir with 3 times 3 kilometers. This is the top view that you can see. And the physical process practically is the 2D depth average diffusion equation with point sources and the seismicity rate obtained by Siegel and Liu 2015. The static wells that we call are practically wells that inject with a constant rate, and actually they are perturbations to the system. What we call control wells are wells that we want to control the seismicity in this region, and on top of that, we want to produce a constant energy with a flux of 1.2 cubic meter per second. What we measure in this example is the average seismicity rate of the reservoir, and we want to stabilize the seismicity rate in its background rate, in its background value. The closed loop responses, as you can see here. So we have the average seismicity in terms of time. Now the T operation is 3 months, and we compare the open loop and the closed loop response. The open loop corresponds to the case where only static wells are working, meaning only we perturb the system, and we can clearly see the difference between the two lines. So we manage with our control strategy to reduce the seismicity in the region by 2 orders of magnitude. And on top of that, we did that by adjusting the pressures in these 5 control wells. But we did something else. We maintained constant injection rate in the reservoir, and also we maintain constant energy production in our reservoir. So in terms of the fluxes of the control wells, the middle well, which is this black curve, only produces energy, while the other 4 only inject to the system. So practically, this method, as far as we have a constant production, constant energy production, can be used in large industrial projects, for instance, in ground and gas field. So now we pass to my last objective, which is the experimental part. It's okay, all this, but we want to test our theory, put in test our theory, or even falsify it, if possible, what we have done up to now. And for that, we design a novel double direct shear apparatus. And we go to a small scale, because small scale is easy to do it. Otherwise, if we go to the field, it's more expensive and the risk is higher. So for our experiment, we use a 3D printed, sun-based 3D printed material, which allows to customize the functional properties of the interface by adequately design the roughness and gauge formation. And the full characterization of this work has been published in a paper 1 year ago, along with Brown and Stefano in JGR. So what is novel about this apparatus? The novelty lies on this fast actuator. It can adjust the effective normal stress really, really fast, of the order of milliseconds. And on top of that, the other novelty is the fact that we try control experiments using control theory. So the frictional interface here that you can see is flat in this example, no specific roughness or geometry, and corresponds to a 5 kilometer fault, assuming some scalings. The swing on top corresponds to the elastic energy stored in surrounding rocks, and it is designed in such a way to provoke dynamic instability. And lastly, on top, we have the ram that's moving downwards, which simulate the far field tectonic displacement. Notice that the system, the machine is too stiff, and it doesn't influence the dynamic response of the experiments. So with that being said, this machine has been installed in our lab, and I have calibrated all the sensors, and I have developed the lab view code there, where we can process everything, process all the variables, and actually I implemented the controller. And here on the left, we see the earthquake lightning stability. And this corresponds to a response like the experimental data that is on the right, where the slip has again the slip a step-like response, reaching a maximum 7 millimeters, and the slip rate reaches a maximum velocity of 0.35 meters per second. This instability takes time in 50 milliseconds. It's really fast. After this first earthquake, numerous earthquakes will take place later on. But the first one that we saw corresponds to a 5.8 earthquake if we apply stimulus. So what if we control this instability in the lab? So for that, we employ a sampling period of 2 to 5 milliseconds, because in reality, we don't have continuous measurements, we have discrete ones. And this sampling period corresponds to the instability to 25 measurements or 10. So we have a few measurements to do the job. So that's why we employ the discrete time control design. And for that, we have the experiment where we measure only the slip. This slip passes through an analog digital converter and we discretize it. Later on, we use a filter, a low pass filter, to calculate the slip the velocity of the block. And all these two are used to the digital controller to design the input. The input where practically is the pressure on the rubber bag. And this input passes through a zero order hold filter and goes to our experimental device. This zero order hold practically introduces a delay, an inherent delay to our system, which is half the sampling period. For that, we use the digital design, which is called the emulation procedure, inspired by the Franklin et al. 1998 book. So the first scenario, we want to induce an seismic slow slip. What is our target? The target is what you see here. We want, instead of having an instability of 50 milliseconds, we want to go from the unstable point to the stable one in 1 hour. And with that being said, here is the response. You can see that indeed, our controller managed to do the job and managed to follow, to track the middle block to follow this trajectory. You can see with the black line. The velocities are quite noisy, but in a rough sense, you can see that they follow again the target slip rate, which is the brown dashed line. If we compare these results with the dynamic event that we saw before, and here I show the diagram with velocity in terms of displacement, the dynamic event is a four orders of magnitude faster than the controlled, the tracking experiment. And to do that, we were adjusting the pressure on the rubber bag. And initially, we could see that the pressure was increasing because we want to reactivate the fault. And when the green dot is reached, this means that the fault is reactivated, then there is a decrease for stabilization, for stabilizing the system, and this goes on forever until our target has been reached. And this is the repeatability of the phenomenon, where we can see close behavior between different experiments. In terms of stabilization, we have a second scenario where we impose a destabilizing fluid pressure, where practically we increase the fluid pressure, we apply a perturbation. And if we do this, the response is the one that you can see here with the blue line on the left. So the pressure on the corresponding controller should change in such a fashion that when the fault is reactivated, to assure that the middle block doesn't move at all. And we can see on the right, the slip response of the system in terms of time on the black curve, that is 60 microns, is half the grain size of the material. And the maximum velocity here is 0.4 millimeters per minute, which corresponds practically in comparison with the dynamic event to four or five orders of magnitude smaller slip rate than the dynamic earthquake event that we saw earlier. To conclude, all the objectives that I have showed you in the very beginning have been accomplished. To be more specific, the main contributions of this thesis are summarized as below. A mathematical theory was developed for controlling earthquake instabilities, which was tested both numerically and experimentally. Control experiments were designed and conducted in the laboratory using both discrete time and continuous time controllers. Even in presence of diffusion phenomena and sparse spatial measurements, the proposed controller approach managed to prevent an earthquake of magnitude 6. In case of a not explicitly defined fault network, it was possible to stabilize the seismicity in a reservoir. A novel double direct shear apparatus of decimetric scale was designed, assembled, and calibrated in our laboratory. A robust controller was developed considering both mass and unmass parameter uncertainties, which uses only minimum and not even exact information from the properties of the system. Additionally, the frictional properties of the sun-based treatment have been characterized and can be customized by adjusting the roughness of the interface. Paper towel can be an ideal low-cost surrogate material considering energy equivalency. And moreover, the experimental results were upscaled to a real fault configuration by applying a David scaling loss. And the slip weakening sufficient for studying an isolated dynamic event. And finally, an extension of the rating state instability condition was derived accounting for also for viscous forces. So the current limitations of this thesis, practically no one could take these results and apply them in real field. Actually, this is the first step towards this direction. And if you ask me, these first results are close to be adjusted and possible. The answer to the question if earthquake control is possible, actually it's adjusted and possible. So the perspective in future work, the steps are the following. Implement the new generation of controllers, test the control algorithm to more complex fault systems with thermohydrodynamical couplings, apply the non-local approach to real reservoirs, like the drone in gas field, upgrade the double direct shear apparatus in order to accommodate direct field injections, perform hybrid tests by simulating numerically in real time diffusion and porous elasticity, and finally design and construct the meter scale apparatus. The list of publications is the following, where two papers have been already published, one submitted, two to be submitted, and two under preparation. One patent is pending, and there are also nine conference articles. Before closing, I would like to thank all my research collaborators in Zen Laboratory, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Georgios, for